guess what Aaron didn't tell you is I'm the father of an adult son with autism. He's in his 30s. So that does date me a little bit. So don't do any big math. I wasn't a young father either. I've been in the trenches with autism for over 3 decades now. And so when my son was about 18 months old, he stopped talking, he started flapping and spinning, what we now call the red flags of autism. And I've been living and learning about autism ever since with him, and along the way I became a clinical psychologist, and I worked with families and people with autism all along the spectrum, from the most impacted to the most able. So I bring that experience to you, and I'm going to talk about, in particular, the way that autism impacts the family, how we can learn and grow from that, how a hard life can be a good life, and the optimism, the good feelings in the air here are certainly electric. So just kind of briefly, this is my outline, beginning with childbirth, and how many of you are parents of children on the spectrum? Okay, wow, okay. How many fathers are here? Let me see that number separately. Okay, great. How many of you are professionals, therapists, teachers, social workers? Wow. Okay, I think we have about 2/3, 1/3. So I'm going to... You'll feel me kind of going in and out of, I have a foot in both worlds. I have, a foot as a clinical psychologist, and I have, probably like more than 5 toes as a parent. So I'll flip in and out of these different roles at times. And hopefully there'll be some time for questions or if you're just moved in the beginning, if it's somewhere in the middle of this, put your hand up. I'll try to work that in if I can. So we're going to talk about how at childbirth, the man becomes a father, the woman becomes a mother, and that couple becomes a family, right? And life changes in that moment, whether that child's typical or autistic. However, if that child is autistic, you will have a different experience from the mainstream. We'll talk a little bit about diagnosis and treatment, a little bit about how men and women relate to each other. And those of you who are therapists, you have relationships too, and you'll be just as interested in this as anybody else. Somewhat about the perspective of brothers and sisters growing up with a sibling with autism, a little bit about adolescence and adulthood, and finally some thoughts on acceptance and what that means. As a lifelong process, not as like, oh yeah, I got the diagnosis, I accept it, but what does it mean day by day by day? So in the month of April, I asked all the families I work with and all the individuals I work with, what does autism mean to you today? What's your awareness today? And from that, we get into like what it means in my life now as an individual. Not just the diagnostic criteria, but how's it impact my life? What are my strengths? What are my challenges? Where am I going with this? So now, just when we think about families, I think the world today and the U.S. today, diversity is the new normal. We have every kind of family. Single mothers, single fathers, blended families, same-sex parents, step-parents, grandparents, adoptive parents, foster parents, and in the minority, nuclear families. Over 65% of children in the U.S. are living in a non-traditional household. However, that does not mean that actually more than half are living with both biological parents. More than half are living with both biological parents, which flies in the face of the myths about what autism does to a family. The reality is that people come together, struggle hard, and are resilient in the face of these difficulties. That's the reality. That's the statistical reality. All right, so just a few thoughts, and then I'm going to show you a brief video. So in the book of Proverbs, and all the Abrahamic religions read this book, that is Jews, Christians, or Muslims, educate each child according to his ways. Now, they weren't talking about autism, they weren't talking about special needs. The prophet who wrote this was talking about parenting. Educate each child according to his needs. It sounds a little like special ed law, right? Right. You have an individual plan, you have methods to fit the child, you collect data, you evaluate regularly, you revise the plan. Really good for everybody. There's a phrase going around the autism community now: what's good for people with autism is good for everybody. What's good for children with autism is good for all children, actually. An individualized education that's based on their strengths, that maximizes their strengths, that minimizes their challenges, that evaluates their progress, that uses data to plan forward. So wait a minute. Oops. Back here. So then, a child's diagnosed with autism. Dr. Bertram Ruttenberg was my son's first child psychiatrist, and his philosophy was you start where the child is and make contact. Start where the child is and make contact. He was a forerunner of Stanley Greenspan. However, this is what every therapist does, is start where the child is. And when we work with families, we have to start where the family is. And not every family member is in the same place. And acceptance of a family implies trying to wrap our minds around people are in different places and how do we relate and communicate, given that. So it's not that easy to start where each family member is, learn together how to cope and grow from there. So that's what we're doing as families and as professionals working with families in the interest of children. So what about data? This is an interesting thing, and it's very important in our community because there's been a lot of false prophets. Like many of you, I've been prey to them, who promised cures, who promised miracles, who said their way was the only way, and who charged exorbitant amounts of money. Anybody here been in that boat? Victim to that? So Einstein had an interesting thing to say. Not everything that can be counted counts, and not everything that counts can be counted. So while data is important, there's stuff we can't exactly count. The relationships we have to each other don't like plot out on a graph. The relationships between a mother and her child, between a father and his child, between professionals and families, they don't plot out, but they're vital. They're vital. And whatever, for professionals, whatever your discipline is, whatever the intervention is, it's occurring within a family that's unique and different, and that needs to be respected as such in order to maximize the effectiveness. So I kind of like this quote. So recently I put together a video, and this has both the current version of me and a clip from when the movie Rain Man came out in 1989, I was interviewed on television. My son was like 9 at the time. So I'm going to use this to put autism awareness and where we are today in perspective. I was a little younger in this video. When the movie Rain Man was released 27 years ago, the incidence of autism was 15 in 10,000, and my son, Tariq, was one of the 15. There was an unprecedented surge of interest in autism, and a TV news reporter came to our home in this clip, which you are about to see.
It is called autism, a disorder that has long been misunderstood by the public and feared by many parents. But a new movie may help change public perception.
Well, I have to let you drive sometime.
Never touch the steering wheel when I'm driving. Do you hear me? Do you hear me?
Of course, I don't have my underwear.
What?
I'm definitely not wearing my underwear.
Rain Man is a box office success. But more than that, it has raised consciousness about autism. In the movie, Dustin Hoffman portrays an autistic savant, a person who uncontrollably focuses all his energy on one scale, like memorizing long lists of numbers.
How much is 4,343 times 1,234?
5359262. He's a genius, right?
On the other hand, he couldn't tell you how much money buys what.
You know how much a candy bar costs?
$500.
The movie was comforting to me because I thought from the movie a lot of people could start to understand.
Robert Nassif, a psychotherapist and educator by profession, is the parent of an autistic child, 9-year-old Tariq. Like most autistic children, and unlike Dustin Hoffman's character, he does not talk, read, or write.
With the special care and schooling that Tariq has received, he's been able to pick up on some of the little things, like being able to put on his socks and tying his shoes. And he can even give me five. Give me five. All right. But it's the major things, like talking and being able to comprehend the danger of running in front of a school bus, that he does not comprehend.
He can develop, he can learn a lot of things, but he won't develop to that point. That's not really possible.
The disability is rare. Only 15 of every 10,000 people get it. There is no cure. And while some can make progress through special care and education, services are extremely limited. But in Pennsylvania, for the purposes of providing services, there is no law, regulation, or guideline even recognizing autism as a disorder. State legislators are considering changing that and setting aside money to establish treatment programs.
Give me a hug.
Meantime, parents of such children are hoping the movie Rain Man will raise consciousness enough to make a difference.
We've come a long way in awareness since that video, but accepting and supporting the full range of unique individuals, from the nonverbal to the extremely articulate, requires action. This is a public health crisis and a moral imperative for society. Last summer, self-advocate Dr. Stephen Schur and I played a leading role in preparing young adults for employment through collaboration with the ARC of Philadelphia, the Pennsylvania Department of Vocational Rehabilitation, and the SAP Autism at Work program. This is a fantastic program for those with the skills, but what happens for people who cannot become independent in adulthood? Many promising programs are in the works. For a humane society, we must vigorously advocate for all children and families so that each and every human being can have a place where they can flower. That's on YouTube if you want to show anybody or see it again. Any reactions? Questions? Thoughts? Yes.
I had a question. In the earlier video that was taken, you had kind of said like that you had come to some acceptance that he was just never going to get there to those points. Have you changed your perspective at this point?
He hasn't changed. In his 30s. He's the grown-up version of that little boy. By the way, he was eating gluten-free crackers in there. So I would have changed if he changed, but it wasn't for a lack of effort.
Sure.
He's had, you know, good help all along the way. He has good help now. This is just who he is, and I've learned to love him just as he is, without a word. Without a word, he's made me become who I am. He's been teaching me every day. And I'd say most of them. You know, when he was young, I'd say a little before that video, I was very depressed, and I thought I would never laugh or smile again if he didn't talk to me. And he never talked to me, except in my dreams. But he knows me, and if you saw us together, you would see that we are close. And so I come to you with my life in that world, and my professional life is also in the world of what's called high-functioning autism, where I'm teaching and training young people to be ready to go to work. And believe me, that's what I hope my son would be, and it's just who he isn't. But he's just as lovable, and in fact, he's taught our family more by just being who he is. And that's, you know, been the journey. Anybody else? Yeah, Wolf.
Yeah. Well, you know, I'm an autism advocate, and one of the things, you have the clip about Rain Man, and I hate to tell you this, but I have had to debunk more, you know, when you talk about autism, their minds go to one of two things, Rain Man, and they expect me to know, like, you know, the calculations. or they think that you're a guy, you know, when you say autism, they think that you sit there and you rock and you drool into a cup and, you know, everybody can talk to you and you're just completely clueless. And what people don't tend to realize is, of course, that it is a spectrum, and that, like they always say, if you meet one autistic person, that's what you've met. It's one autistic person. You can't do the generalization. I guess, have you seen how people are so wedded to the Rain Man as the picture of what autism is? Because I run into it all the time.
No, I definitely run into it. And when I show this to self-advocates, they usually get mad at me. Because it's a doubt. Yes! I knew I was taking a risk with you. However, you know, this does date me a little bit. Rain Man is significant because it unleashed a global wave of autism awareness. And that's why it's significant, not because it's Dustin Hoffman's character represents even the tiniest part of the spectrum of autism. But what that movie did was create awareness and build organizations all around the world. At the time that Rain Man came out, I was at the very first Autism Awareness Day at the Philadelphia Zoo, and it was about like this corner of the room, about four or five picnic tables. And a couple of years ago, I was at the zoo again, and it was the whole zoo. You know, and Rain Man like kind of started that movement, but it's got its limitations, and now a lot of people haven't seen it even. So I kind of thought it long and hard before I dug out this whole video, but I thought putting this in perspective is like a useful thing. So there's like some friends of mine saw it and said, "Oh my gosh, you were younger." Yeah. And then another friend of mine said, "But I like the vintage version of you." So I'm here as the vintage version.
I love that.
So 2016, 1 in 68 children are diagnosed with ASD. 1 in 42 boys, pretty startling. 1 in 189 girls, all of whom are part of the human family. And we now understand autism as a naturally occurring variation of the human spectrum. So signs like this, autistic child at play, are going up near where I live in Pennsylvania. Used to be like blind child at play, deaf child at play. Now we're seeing autistic child at play. There's a picture of Autism Awareness Day at the Philadelphia Zoo a few years ago that I just mentioned. So being and becoming a parent, I mentioned this in my introduction. This is from Daniel Stern, a child psychiatrist, and his wife, Nadia Bruchweiler Stern. Dr. Stern, one of the preeminent minds in early infant development, who passed away recently. But the authors say this: as the infant emerges, there's two other births. The woman becomes a mother, the man becomes a father, the family is born, the experience of parenthood changes us forever. And they weren't talking about autism, they were talking about having a baby. Having a baby changes us forever. Changes our identity. So, like many parents of children with autism, well over 95%, my son was normal for the first 18 months. And you can see in this photo, he's one day old, he's making eye contact with me. So often, professionals don't fully grasp what this means for families. Because we lived for a good period of time believing we had a normal, healthy baby. And then, slowly, the baby starts to slip away. The red flags emerge. The baby gets more and more distant. Actually, we now know, sort of late in the first year, but usually not becoming evident until well into the second year. And so, the acceptance or the realization of my baby will be different for the rest of her life or his life is a very painful process and a slow process for parents. And denial exists because it is so painful. Denial exists until we are ready to face what is real. Face with support on the outside and strength on the inside. So, just a few other photos. He raised his head about 4 months. I'm the photographer. He's looking at me.
Adorable.
Kind of adorable, no? I'm throwing him up in the air. It's a typical father and son thing. Oh, so typical. And fathers are often thrown for a loop because once a baby's diagnosed with special needs, we don't know how to play anymore. And because we don't know how to play anymore, we feel useless and excluded from the process. I love this picture. I love that outfit. So here we are, we're, you know, playing with this stacking toy, and he's looking at me after we finished, right? I'm the photographer. What do we call this? Somebody say it louder.
Joint attention.
Joint attention. And this is the focus, one of the focuses of early intervention with children with autism is developing joint attention. The communication back and forth between parent and child. And we all have joint attention, like I look over there and you look over there to see what I'm looking at, that's joint attention. I don't have to tell you I'm looking over there. So that's one of the things we work on in the therapy, and we work on it like from the diagnosis, like on and on and on. We are always working on relating and communicating, joint attention being the way it occurs, you know, with the infant and beyond. So this little shirt says future quarterback. So like I dreamed he was gonna play sports, not football, but sports. My dad played sports with me. I wanted to play sports with my son. I wanted to do a better job than my dad, who wasn't that patient. Reasonable. Wasn't a high bar, but that's what me and my brother say. Wasn't a high bar to be patient with our kids. However, my son was not to play sports, right? If you kick a soccer ball to him, like he'll just kick it away to get it out of his way. He's not interested in this. He walked on his birthday, and that was like the Super Bowl. You know, again, I'm the photographer, he's walking toward me. I set him up in the middle of the floor, and he takes his few halting steps, and I celebrate. I celebrated everything he did. Everything he did. And you know I still do, but now, like many parents, they're not milestones, these little steps. They're more like inch notes, but they're even more valuable. They're even more precious. But that's what I had to learn in this process. His second summer, he stopped talking. We're at the beach, and he's just playing in the sand, stimming, as we now call it, playing repetitively, not interested in his sisters, mom, me, anybody, just the sand, over and over and over. And I thought his speech would come back. He spoke once, he'll speak again. And for a lot of kids on the spectrum, it does. Some it even comes back fluently, but some it doesn't. Probably one-third or more of children on the spectrum are nonverbal, and that's not the group we hear about now, unfortunately, and that's a group that faces far steeper challenges. However, I think it's a group that's easier to accept. Bring your mind to balance, because if you have one of the more mildly affected kids, you just want to push and push until they can get closer and closer to normal. And I am sure I would be that father if he spoke. I am sure I would. So in some ways, I do know who I'd be without him. Without him, I'd be the father at the Little League game screaming at the umpire it was a bad call. I'd be that guy. My brothers are that guy. I'm not that guy. I am so not that guy. So I'm not going to go over this slide, but you know, this is the red flags, the you know, the stuff that's coming up early, the stuff that's troubling parents, the stuff that's sort of popping out in early intervention, and people are, and this whole thing's online if you want to download it. I mean, you're welcome to take pictures of it, but the whole thing's online. Get the whole handout. So then, you know, those red flags start popping up, and for some folks, they pop up early. The baby who wouldn't nurse, the baby who didn't know his mom. The mom feels like my baby doesn't know me. These are really horrible situations. Painful situations. So, whoops, I gotta stop that. I'm a little too stimmy. But, you know, this confusion. And I think if there's one word that typifies the beginning of this journey, is how alone parents feel. How alone. You know, even though it's now 1 in 68, when it happens to you, it's how alone you feel. The people I talked to today, mirror what I felt like when it was, and actually at my son's birth, at my son's diagnosis, it was 5 in 10,000. By the time he's 9 years old and Raymond comes out, it's 15 in 10,000. Awareness was like starting to pick up slowly. But still, that initial experience is how alone I am and how hard it is to talk about. I know I couldn't get the A word out of my mouth. Parents today, they still tell me it's the A word. You know, I'll go back here. So fear, guilt, depression, anxiety, grief, and loneliness. And I have a friend who has a kid with more severe autism than mine, if that's imaginable. My son isn't violent, his son is. And this kid, and you know, the father's a physician, his mother's a physician, and they know there's no cure. They know there's no cure. There's no cure for his seizures, there's no cure for him putting his head in the wall when he has the seizures, although it's gotten slightly better. So my friend is telling me, my life is Groundhog Day, my life is Groundhog Day, and I didn't totally get what he was talking about. And then I went and I rewatched the movie. And I was like, oh my gosh. It's not just autism, it's something about life. So I want to show you the trailer to Groundhog Day. And I think we could think of our challenges as similar to Groundhog Day. Whatever our challenges are, whether we have a kid with autism or not, life might be like Groundhog Day. Here it comes.
It's Groundhog Day!
Groundhog time.
1,000 people freezing their butts off waiting to worship a rat.
Weatherman Bill Connors is spending the day in Punxsutawney, Pennsylvania.
Phil! Ned Ryerson, I did the whistling belly button trick at the high school talent show.
Bing!
Bing!
But Phil's about to find out. He's not just stuck in Punxsutawney.
Will you be checking out today, Mr. Congress?
Chance of departure today, 100%.
He's stuck.
Groundhog Day!
Groundhog Day.
I'm reliving the same day over and over.
Phil!
Ned Ryerson?
Bing!
Do you ever have deja vu, Miss Flagster?
I don't think so, but I could check with the kitchen.
Well, it's Groundhog Day. Again?
At first, he was a little anxious.
Phil? What?
Are you checking out today, Mr. Collins?
I'd say the chance of departure is 80%. But now,
we could do whatever we want. He's discovering the possibility.
Don't you worry about cholesterol?
Why?
And living life like there's no tomorrow.
Phil Connors!
Ned! I am immortal. I have been stabbed, shot, burned, frozen, electrocuted. I'm a god.
You're god.
I'm a god. I'm not the god.
He's out of his gourd.
But to get what his heart wants most.
Are you looking for Phil a date for the weekend?
Means living this day over again till he gets it right.
Believe it or not, I studied 19th century French poetry.
want to waste the time.
I study 19th century French poetry.
Merci, qui je m'en.
You speak French.
Oui. Bill Murray. Andy McDowell.
To the Groundhog.
Always drink to world peace. What should we drink to?
I like to say prayer and drink to world peace.
Don't drive angry. Don't drive angry.
He might be okay.
Yes! Groundhog Day!
Life has a funny way of repeating itself.
What did you do today?
Oh, same old, same old.
Does that make sense? And the thing is, it's for all of us, really. It's for all of us that things have a way of repeating until we figure out a way to deal with them differently. But keep repeating. And what can change that we have power over is how we relate to the situation. So how many people were here yesterday for the keynote? A lot of you. Okay, so in acceptance, commitment, therapy, the same kind of concept is there. You know, how do we see the situation? What are other ways of looking at the situation? And how do our values help us figure out a way to go forward in the situation? So it's kind of, this is congruent with that. And this is, the popularized version. This has become a modern classic, this movie. There's the 15th anniversary DVD edition came out, I guess, 2 years ago. So I did a weekend retreat of fathers a couple years ago, and on Friday night we watched the whole movie, and that was just incredibly set up the whole weekend of sharing about what it was like to be a father in this situation. So if the main character, Bill Murray, does nothing different, then events repeat, but when he changes his behavior, people start to respond to him differently. And then there's new possibilities. So we can all begin to relate to our lives differently, accepting a couple of things. That change is inevitable. Nothing actually stays exactly the same. The change is inevitable, and believing that's possible. And even in the toughest situations, life keeps unfolding and shifting. It's never exactly the same, especially as we begin relating differently. So a little bit just about the spectrum concept, coming back, is this is a graphic where, at the dark end here, that's classic autism or Connor's autism. The middle, and now these would be severe, moderate, slight, or light, autism light, mild, moderate, severe, mild, moderate, severe. But what happens is, no matter where a child is when they are diagnosed, chances are good they will move along this spectrum. So we have self-advocates today who are nonverbal at 4, who are lawyers and PhDs in adulthood, because they have slowly progressed along the spectrum. But individuals vary in their ability to learn and move along this spectrum. But when a child's diagnosed, chances are excellent that they will learn. But how much they will learn, that's the part, that's the huge uncertainty that parents live with. I just got back from a week in Kuwait where I do second opinions on autism. And the questions that parents were asking me there were the same questions I was asking myself when my son was young. How severe is this? Is this mild? And actually, usually they weren't mild cases, because you get outside of this country, And mild cases don't tend to be diagnosed nearly as much because they don't have the infrastructure of services to take care of people that are more mildly impacted. So, but people were asking the same questions. Women with their faces covered were asking me the same questions as moms here. Men with their heads covered or not covered were weeping and telling me they were grieving and they didn't know what to do and they were powerless. But I could give them this message that their children could learn and that they could have a meaningful relationship and that the future was uncertain. And somehow that's the same theme as for every child, except it's a matter of degree. What do the parents of typical kids have that the parents of kids with autism don't have? They have the illusion that everything will be okay. And the reality is a lot of stuff happens and it's not always okay. But that we can learn and grow and cope and bounce back and keep going and have a good life while we deal with the difficulties that are part of the human condition. So it's like looking for these basic human threads, I find, that's the best thing for everybody, especially the best thing for people who have autism in the family, is to look for the commonalities, but not to make light of the differences. We can't just say, oh, that's just when your six-year-old's having a meltdown, we can't just say, oh, that's the same as a toddler having a tantrum. No, that's not the same. That's not the same. And it's not the same when an adult with autism has a meltdown and has to leave the room or go inside. That's not the same. But the similarities help us to bridge the gap. But we have to honor the differences, and they're significant. Wherever a child falls on this spectrum, wherever, to say that's 1 to 2% of the population, there is a huge drop-off to the other 98%. So wherever you fall, mild, moderate, severe, this is still hugely different than the rest of the spectrum of humanity. And there's no clear dividing line between what's on this spectrum and what's off. So there's a lot of people have one foot here and one foot there. And if you're meeting a lot of parents of young kids, it's often true that one or two of the parents have some or all the characteristics. That's becoming more and more common that we see that. It's probably always been there, but now we see it because now we know what the milder variations of autism look like and how they're just part of the human condition. And what puts somebody, you know, from over here to over here, that's the DSM criteria. Do they have difficulty relating and communicating and repetitive activities that separate them from their peers? That's what puts somebody on this. But the characteristics are human, and it's just having a certain number of them that keep hold us back that put us on the spectrum, or not. Does that make any sense? All right, so here's the no clear dividing line. Like red and orange, no clear dividing line. Orange and yellow, no clear dividing line, right? So it's kind of like the color spectrum in that regard. So the history of this, kind of interesting. Just a few concepts that I think put things in context. Leo Kanner was the first observer of this phenomena. Actually, the first observer here. How many people are familiar with Neurotribes? Steve Silberman? Yeah, read that book. Get that book. Get him here, he's kind of pricey, but get him here if you can. Or just read the book. Anyway, Hans Asperger actually saw that this was a spectrum, and Kanner actually did it. Okay, it's not that they didn't translate to each other. They were both German speakers, and they were contemporaries, and they knew about each other. Kanner actually hired people out of Asperger's lab who were Jewish to get them, you know, so that to save their lives. So some of Asperger's staff actually worked with Kanner. So, but they saw this differently, and Kanner initially just saw this as this severe variation. But he followed these kids 30 years later as adults, and he found out that that many of them had progressed without intervention. So this is called the natural course of something. They progressed without intervention. And you know, one was married, a couple had jobs. The ones that didn't progress were the ones that were institutionalized by their families. But the best known predictors of outcome, because people want to know, well, what's going to help somebody move along? The best known predictors are cognitive ability, language development, and age of diagnosis. So being diagnosed young, having average or above intelligence, and fluent language are the best prognosticators of movement along that spectrum. So changes in screening and diagnosis plus early intervention actually alter the course of autism. So we actually see many individuals moving way along the spectrum and others not because, and also the atypical behaviors or extreme behaviors predict against a lot of development. But wherever a child begins, chances are good that child becomes less impaired over time. And that's how we can look to the future with hope. We can work hard to make everything possible happen. I'll talk a little bit about that at the end today. So there's wide variability and uniqueness, as Wolf was pointing out. But here's the problem, I think, with the terms low functioning and high functioning. When we think about low functioning, often the individual with autism has abilities that are not acknowledged. There's nonverbal people who can program a computer. There's people with very little language who have amazing skills to do things. And there's so-called high-functioning people who are really challenged with emotional regulation and who have a difficult time living in the world, and yet they're expected to. And their challenges aren't fully recognized because they have high IQs and they're very articulate. But they can be held back, usually by some of their challenges. So really important to understand the challenges that exist all along the functional levels of this. Frequently, in our practice in Philadelphia, I'll get a phone call from parents who say, you know, my son is so high functioning. And I say, like, well, why are you calling me? How can I help you? Oh, he's 30 years old, he graduated on the dean's list, he's just playing computer games. Well, that's not really high functioning in the world. Not really. In life skills, that's not high functioning. He's very intelligent. But, you know, so now we have a generation of young people diagnosed with Asperger's who aren't getting jobs because they don't fit the social criteria of the world of employment. So that's why these terms are misleading. And even mild, moderate, and severe are misleading. Level 1, level 2, and level 3 in the DSM can also be misleading. But we have to really look to uniqueness and understanding the individual. There's no real terms that kind of get us away from that very simple process. So now, what's going on in families? Donald Wincott was a British child psychiatrist, and he had a show on the BBC where he talked to moms about parenting. And this wasn't an autism show. And he put it this way: I think mothers are helped by being able to voice their agonies at the time they are experiencing them. Bottled up resentment spoils the loving, which is at the back of it all. Make sense? Does this make sense for fathers? Raise your hands. Stand up if it does. I need to sit down right now.
I think fathers don't talk about it.
That's right. We have a very hard time talking about it. We don't talk about things we can't fix. We don't talk about things that hurt because we have to keep a strong face, a tight upper lip, because our definition of manhood is to be independent, to be the fixer, to be strong, which means don't show our pain. A boy shows his pain, he's a sissy. He's a wuss. So fathers can't talk about this, and mothers can. And mothers actually get comfort out of it. I haven't met men who get comfort out of this. Not until they learn how to talk about this with other men, usually. And mothers are passionate and obsessed with this. Now, Winnicott again, primary maternal preoccupation, and again, he's talking about typical kids, primary and typical moms, primary maternal preoccupation is a consuming attachment to one's baby, a normal sickness from which most mothers recover. Right? All the mothers here, you know about this, right? And he's talking about the mothers of typical kids. They have a little less to be preoccupied with. And they didn't have Google. Oh my gosh. I am glad there was no Google when my son was little. That would not have helped me. Go on Google, I don't have the slide here. Go on Google today, and there's something like 21 million web pages about autism. And then go to Amazon, and there's something like 21,000 books. So where do you start? Like, the information itself is a trauma. But where you actually start is with professionals and organizations you can have relationships with and trust the information you're getting. That's where you can actually get some comfort and get steered toward the information that is going to be most useful to you and most evidence-based. Right, so that's the major autism organizations, the major disability organizations, you know, any and all of those are my sources, primarily. So now what's happening in the world of intervention? So for years, there's been this controversy between the behaviorists and the developmentalists, but the contemporary models, and unfortunately, families kind of get stuck in the middle of that. Barry Prezant, who's a speech therapist, he's a speech pathologist, he has a very nice essay called ADA Isn't the Only Way, where he talks about, you know, the blending of models. And you can Google that and get that essay. Travis Thompson, who's a behavior analyst, wrote a book on individualized autism intervention. And he described how autism became a battlefield among the warring factions of psychology, much to the detriment of children, their families, and therapists, and treatment, which is often complicated regardless of the theory driving it, can be planned with a blend of approaches that's logical and child-centered. So I think everything's moving in this way toward logical, blended, child-centered. Right, the Denver model and other things really offer us a way. Unfortunately, a lot of therapists were trained, during, like, when there was more open warfare. And some of my colleagues still, like, they're constantly, like, criticizing each other. And I just want to tell them to just, like, shut up and do your job. Because when you see a good therapist with a kid, they really, like, look the same regardless of the theory in their head. But there's still, a lot of the kind of after effects of this stuff. But positive behavioral support is a blended kind of thing. The Denver model, DIR, STAR, they all now incorporate blended approaches because we have to understand the child as a unique developing individual. We have to understand the principles of behavior, and why do we have to understand that? The simplest way I could put it to you is that children with autism need more extrinsic rewards. They're not good at finding the intrinsic ones, so they need extrinsic rewards to kind of make steps to move forward, and that's why behavior analysis is so powerful in helping people understand that. It doesn't mean you make everything contingent on an external reward, but it does mean that you need to, like, look at this process to help a child grow up, and children need different amounts of this. Here's my son's psychiatrist, Dr. Rutberg, and the reason I have him here, he's my favorite Jewish Santa Claus. He dressed up like Santa Claus every year, and our kids were like his grandkids, the 40 kids in his center. He put everyone on his lap. And he's still alive, he's in his 90s now. And he connected me, this is a very interesting thing, he connected me with my contact in the Arab world. And I go there regularly to consult in Kuwait The founder of the Kuwait Center for Autism is a mother of a kid with autism who contacted him because he developed the first autism rating scale that you never heard the name of, that was a predecessor of the ADOS. And she had read about that, contacted him. You know, he said, do you read Arabic? I was like, no. But anyway, I got in touch with her, and now I'm blessed to be able to be helpful in another part of the world. But he just loved our kids, you know? And I sat down in Kuwait, and somebody's looking at me through the one-way mirror, and I'm like, doing these evaluations, I'm doing the ADOS, and there's a psychologist on the other side of the mirror in the beginning, and at the end, she came over to me, and she said, now I'm like, go see what's in that picture, you know? And she came over, and she said to me, you know, it's like you love our kids. I was like, wow, I finally got there. I finally got to the point I could be the mellow old guy helping people love their kids, but I wasn't always that guy. I was not always that guy. So, is autism a puzzle to be solved or a child to be loved, you know? You know, we got the puzzle ribbon. Actually, I don't see a whole lot of them here today. That's okay, because there's a little problem with the ribbon, although it's certainly symbolic of our community. If we view the child as a puzzle, we're going to miss out on the loving. We're going to miss out on the uniqueness if we have to solve everything, and it's not all solvable. That's the problem. It's a dichotomy. We can solve parts of it, and parts of it we have to let go. Get back. Get out of the way. And it's finding that balance that's acceptance. And it's ongoing. It's ongoing. So, now this afternoon I'm going to do a breakout on autism and intimate relationships, but I've just got a little part here. Josh Greenfield is a Hollywood screenwriter. I don't think he's still alive. He wrote 3 books about his son with autism. And this is the way he put it. There's a strain on any marriage whenever a baby is sick, and we always have a sick baby. That's not that autism is an ongoing sickness, but it feels like something's wrong with your baby every day. So when you have a baby and the baby has a cold, you lay awake at night, or you wake up and you're checking, is my baby breathing? Is my baby okay, right? And this goes on and on and on when you have a child with autism. You worry and you worry and you worry. I didn't sleep through the night for at least 10 years. And that makes you another person. My son still doesn't sleep through the night, but he's in a residential setting where it's somebody's job to be awake. But that makes you a different person when you walk around sleep deprived. And how many of you have kids with autism that don't sleep through the night? That don't, yeah. Plenty. And there's a bunch of people not here who say that because they're too tired to be here. And that is a tough place to be. The 80% divorce rate is a myth. What's true is that there's more distress, more hopelessness. That myth is a self-fulfilling prophecy. And basically, the diagnosis of autism is not a prognosis of divorce. You have an article in the handouts where myself and Brian Friedman broke out the research on that. And Brian Friedman did one of the research studies. But prior to 2010, there was no evidence linking autism spectrum and divorce. So prior to 2010, when we had 3 studies after that, the research was sparse and contradictory. We do know that marital conflict occurs with children with special needs during the adjustment. Some marriages improve. There's certainly greater stress for single parents. And the disability is often a red herring that distracts from other issues in the relationship. But poverty, racism, and mental illness make this harder. In fact, children of color today are diagnosed later, more frequently misdiagnosed. In prior years, children of color were diagnosed with mental retardation Today, they're more generally misdiagnosed with behavioral disorders as opposed to developmental disorders. And the average age of diagnosis for children of color is 2 to 3 years later than for European American children. My son was diagnosed at age 4 and a half. That is still the average age of diagnosis in our country, despite the ability to diagnose by age 2. So autism and the stress can be the straw that broke the camel's back in the families that have divorce. However, over 60% of children with autism are living with both biological parents. So I'm going to talk about that more in the afternoon. But the difference between men and women, I have a 57-second clip from Friends, which does this in the form of comedy.
Ross kissed me. No! Oh my God, oh my God, oh my God! Unbelievable! Oh my God, oh my God, oh my God!
Okay, all right, we want to hear everything. Monica, get the wine and unplug the phone. Rachel, does this end well or do we need to get tissues?
Oh, it ended very well.
Oh, do not start without me! Do not start without me! Okay, all right, let's hear about the kiss. Was it like a soft brush against your lips, or was it like a, you know, I gotta have you now kind of thing?
Well, at first it was really intense, you know, and then, oh God, and then we just sort of sunk into it.
Oh, so, okay, was he holding you, or was his hands like on your back?
No, actually, first they started out on my waist, and then they slid up, and then they were in my hair.
Oh.
And then I kissed her.
Tom?
Yeah.
Cool.
You can illustrate almost any concept with a clip from YouTube. So what's the moral of the story there? The moral of the story that I'll talk about more in the other workshop is that sex helps men to feel better and feel romantic, whereas for women, feeling better and feeling love helps women feel sexual. So this is kind of a sort of a mismatch, and unless we learn how to understand each other, there's a problem. And this is true for many couples, and it's especially true for couples that have children with autism, and I'll talk about that more and how that plays out and what to do about it. But briefly, it's really essential that fathers get involved and step up in the care of children and get past not being able to talk about it to become a full partner in parenting. That's basically what's necessary. Not for more sex, but for a better relationship. If you have a better relationship, you might have a little more sex. So I did a weekend workshop in Minneapolis a couple of years ago, and one guy kept saying, but if I do this, will I get more sex? And it's like, his wife is right there. This depends on other people, not me. So again, I'm always putting this experience, having a kid with autism, in a broader context. So John and Julie Gottman are, you know, a couple of the leading authorities and researchers on romantic relationships, married life, long-term partnerships. They did a study a number of years ago, and it's been replicated several times, that when a baby arrives, everything changes. Parents must adapt to the 24/7 care of a new vulnerable infant, which is an enormous task, and not surprisingly, 40 to 70% of all couples experience stress, profound conflict, and drops in marital satisfaction during this time, all of which affect their baby's care. So, 40 to 70% of couples experience this difficulty, and importantly, drops in marital satisfaction. And that influences the baby's care. And so when the baby has autism, that influences the baby's care. And that is harder to overcome. But this is the journey of all couples adapting to being parents. So with sort of autism for spice, autism just added to the picture. But we also know that since people aren't breaking up in record numbers, that it's creating resilience, that people are bouncing back, that they're staying together, that they're figuring it out, not that it's easy. But that despite the stereotype, the stress is higher, but people are figuring it out, they're staying together, they're loving each other and loving their kid, and they're making a life that matters. That's what's going on. And taking care of yourself as parents is vital. This is, you know, this graphic is based on the whole safety thing when you get on an airplane, you know. If we lose air pressure, then be sure to put the oxygen on you first and then your child, because if you can't breathe, your child can't breathe. So it's really hard to help moms take care of themselves. Why is that hard? Somebody tell me why that's hard. Why do you hate that? Somebody says that to you.
It's hard to prioritize yourself when you see so much need in your child.
It's hard to prioritize yourself, absolutely. Why else is that hard? Does that get to you when somebody says you should take care of yourself? You should take care of yourself.
It implies that you're not.
You're not, which means what?
You're not being a good mom.
Failing.
Yeah, this is something else you're doing wrong when somebody talks to you like that. So I think the better question is, like, when can you get a little break once in a while? I think that's a little better question. But even this question tends to overwhelm moms, I find. So I don't really ask it. Not too much. I'll try to listen until they talk about how they can't get a break. Like, moms tell me things like, I can't even die. That really settled it. Dads tell me that too, but it takes a lot longer to get there. But they tell me the same thing. I can't even die. Who's going to take care of this kid? Who maybe can't be independent. So, but carving out a little time. How do you get a little break for yourself? A key thing for families. Key thing for families. Some families of kids on the spectrum can kind of network with each other and, you know, give each other breaks. In-home dates, I mean, there's a lot of coping strategies. We'll talk about them more in the afternoon. I think there's ways to deal with all this, but it's very challenging. It's very challenging. So some tips for couples, which I think the key thing is men learning to listen without trying to fix, and that's really hard for us. It's a little better if you tell us, just listen, that's all I need from you. And the best question for a man to a woman is, what do you need from me? This is the question my wife and daughters have taught me to ask. What do you need from me? And we all need to hear what we're doing right. We know from behavior analysis that we need 4 reinforcements for every correction. How many relationships have 4 reinforcements or 5 reinforcements for every correction? Don't all stand up? Same thing applies. So, you know, these are some of the concepts I think that are helpful for families. I'm checking my time here. I got till 10:30. All right. Somebody's going to tell me it's 10 minutes. All right. So siblings. You know, I think as parents, we have this image of like a cozy set of kids, and when we're gone, the kids are tight, and they look out after each other and all of that. My daughter Zoe, she's my youngest, and she's in college now, she wrote an essay when she was 11. And I think what she said, not that I haven't heard other variations of this, but she put it in writing. She called her brother Dad Hopper. My brother always hugs my dad. Whenever we go canoeing, dad hugs her. When we go hiking, dad hugs her. Every time he's around and I try to go near my dad, dad hugs her. So the child with autism takes more of our attention, and that is unavoidable. That is just the reality of it. But how do we deal with that? Right? That's Groundhog Day. But how do we deal with that? There is a relatively straightforward way of thinking about it, which is to give each child some special attention, to attend to the special needs of each child. It's expecting our typical children to be stars and develop normally without our support that burdens them. That's what burdens them. It's not the autism that burdens them. They love their brother and sister. They have the parent-sized version of this. They feel rejected that their brother or sister doesn't want to play with them or is difficult to play with. They feel left out. They feel a lot of the same stuff parents feel. And sometimes the younger child may surpass the older child developmentally. You saw my daughter in the background of the video. Like, she didn't want to talk on the video. She didn't want to talk in my latest book. She does not want to be known through having a brother with autism. She wants to be known as the individual she is. That's not an unusual response. I won't tell you, I won't lie to you and say, oh, that was okay with me. That broke my heart that she didn't want to talk in my latest book. But I respect that. I just respect that. But sometimes when the younger child surpasses the older child, if the older child has autism, the birth order is like reverse. The best birth order in terms of family coping is the child with autism being youngest. Then everybody takes care of the youngest. That's the easiest configuration for everybody to wrap their minds around. But the child with autism as the oldest or the middle, that's harder to sort of, but children who are developing typically with children with autism need information at their age level. It's like sex. They need information about autism at their age level. This should be talked about as if it's not, as if it's just everyday life. So this slide just talks about what siblings want and need. They want parents to notice their accomplishments, a fair amount of attention. They want time alone with their parents. They want time alone with their friends. They don't want to have to be, you know, the inclusive family all the time. They want freedom to complain. They want as normal a life as possible, and they desperately need information about their brother or sister's condition. So for young children and children on the autism spectrum, one of the books I recommend is All Cats Have Asperger's Syndrome. You know that one? It's a picture book. And actually, the cats are used to illustrate all the qualities of autism. So it's a great book to share with relatives and neighbors. Like in my practice, there's a grandma who's raised her grandson with autism. She bought 10 copies of the book for her extended family. And it's an African-American family who didn't never heard the word autism before. And now they have a young man with autism growing up. And they all just got it, right? They all just got it from that book. Because he had all the qualities in that book. But anyway, so there's a slew of good children's books. It's important to just learn to talk about this and be comfortable with this and just have this be just part of life. Just part of life. And this slide just has some strategies for parents to listen actively, to be a model of acceptance, be an open and honest. You can say it's hard. You can say it's hard for you. You can empathize with your typically developing children. Provide answers at their level. Notice not just what they say, but what they do. And facilitate their questions. Don't just think no news is good news if they aren't saying something. And keep following up on what's going on what's difficult, on what's happening. Of course, you want to encourage interactions with your whole family, but don't get stuck on this. You don't have to do everything together, but do some things together. Look for things everybody enjoys, have realistic expectations that are developmentally a fit. Look for activities and toys that facilitate interaction, teach interaction. Limit caregiving responsibilities. Typically developing children want to help, but it's important to limit their caretaking and not depend on them. and recognize each child's accomplishments day by day by day. So these are just some quick tips. These are some of the books I'd recommend. Thicker Than Water is a collection of essays by adults, adult siblings of people with autism and other disabilities. Sib Shops, do you have that in the area?
We do that.
Yeah, Sib Shops is really great for the siblings. A fabulous approach, Don Meyer from Seattle. And Siblings Without Rivalry is a wonderful book and has a chapter on children with special needs, and it's illustrated with comics. So that's a good resource. So here's the thing, and this is where I think the autism community as a whole is starting to focus now, is that these little kids with autism are growing up and they become teenagers with autism and they become adults with autism. So as they're becoming teenagers, the worrying about bullying's increasing. Sexuality is dawning. And thinking about independence, we can no longer defer. We're now looking at, can my family member with autism be independent? What will it take if so? And if we think of this longer, slower trajectory, a lot more is possible. And think about adolescence in the US today goes well into the 20s because it takes longer to become independent. But teens, so that's everybody, but teens with ASD are more vulnerable. And unfortunately, as kids with autism are growing up, the services become less adequate. And so there's mood swings and rebellion. That's normal, but it's exacerbated. The autistic meltdowns are, you know, still there as part of it. We're going to hear more about that later after lunch. And many teens, now here's something I've learned in my practice, and there's some literature on this, but not much. But many teens worry that they may be homosexual. And for boys, they've been around boys their whole lives, very few girls, in autism programs, therapies, etc., social skills groups, etc. And it's harder to resolve the gay or straight thing because of the tendency of the mind to get stuck. But what we know statistically is that it doesn't seem to be a major impact. Maybe a little. But getting stuck on it is. And in the population as a whole, there's more confusion about sexual orientation. But at the end of the day, statistically shakes out almost the same. That's what we know about the general population, where we have a lot of data. Not too much data on teens with autism. But I've seen certainly a lot more worrying. I have boys talking to me about they just love looking at these male cartoon characters and they get kind of excited. And they're like, does that mean I'm gay? I'm like, I don't know. But it's the real answer. But that's what's going on. And that's not easy to listen to if you're a parent or a sister or a brother. The confusion may be greater. So Steinberg says, he wrote a book about parenting adolescents, that parents' emotions in response to teenagers may be exacerbated by their own struggle with middle age. So as the parents are becoming middle-aged, kids are becoming teenagers. So, you know, we're kind of thinking about where we've been, one foot back in that world. So the whole transitioning process, you know, in terms of special ed begins in adolescence, age 14, start planning for the future, but the services available are not yet up to what we need them to be. And what about when they grow up? So this picture is a friend of mine, Don White, from the Dallas area. He's actually a Baptist minister. And I think if Jesse Jackson had a child with autism, he would talk like this. So Don White says, development delayed is not development denied. Development delayed is not development denied. So his son, you know, got his first job in his mid-20s. Development delayed is not development denied. So it's that movement along the spectrum that takes longer. It's like a different trajectory. but it's reasonable to expect more. How much, we don't know. So Seltzer in 2010 did a study of 240 young adults over a 10-year period. So in young adulthood, there was improvement in autism symptoms, both external and internal, but the rates of improvement slowed after leaving school because there wasn't as much support. So it kind of makes sense that development continues because people with autism are humans and we all keep developing in adulthood. But the rate of development slowed, especially for those who didn't have intellectual disability, as well as those from a lower socioeconomic status. So without an intellectual disability, there's no guarantee of services. So the parents of kids whose IQ is below 70 are actually, in terms of coping, in better shape for services than the parents of kids whose IQs are over 70. And the major disability organizations are all pushing back on this, and so far we're getting nowhere. In some states, the developmental disability definitions being broadened so that we're looking at life skills as opposed to IQ and more people are getting services. That's really, I think, the wave of change that needs to happen. But as this is happening, and you know, this part is not the good news, as this is happening, there's increased stress for families, especially mothers. That the stress for mothers is going up in adulthood. And this is what I talked about in the video. This is the ethical and moral imperative for society and the professions, is to push for services in adulthood. Now, racism and poverty also, I mentioned this briefly, but here's the references. David Mandel, University of Pennsylvania, and a friend of mine did a number of these studies that showed, you know, definitively that racial and ethnic disparities for African American children were diagnosed 2 years later than European Americans. Now, he hypothesized inadequate screening, slow response to the parents' concerns. Inadequate screening, slow response to the parents' concerns, or a misdiagnosis as a behavioral disorder. And that more educated parents are part of the solution to the problem. So, and Wolf told me his parents were pushing. His parents were pushing. He came from an era where most African American kids were put in the arm, you know, category when they didn't learn normally. And unfortunately, that's still going on. But now it's going into the behavior disorder category. So despite the ability to diagnose children and autism in young children, the parent-professional interaction lies at the heart of the disparities. So it's professionals listening to parents and really looking at that child as an individual and understanding the criteria and what they're seeing and not stereotyping what they're seeing, right? So, and that's probably nobody in this room, that's people in the medical establishment, in the hospitals, and pediatric clinics, and so on. But the creation of awareness in the communities, that's what drives this process forward. Is parents speaking up and pushing back and getting to the right place. So do children recover from autism? This is what people ask everywhere. People ask this in the Middle East. So actually, a small percentage of children do move off the spectrum. And there's a study by Deborah Fine, the sources there. A small number of children move off the spectrum. They communicate and socialize much like their typically developing peers. They still have some of the symptoms. They're affected by anxiety, depression, impulsivity. And that impacts social functioning, right? Like, impulsivity impacts social functioning, but doesn't necessarily qualifies autism. So these individuals, the ones that moved off the spectrum, there were certain characteristics she noted. They had milder symptoms at the outset. They learned to process faces early on through intensive intervention, and they had fewer self-stimulatory or repetitive behaviors. They had that in the very beginning, and this small, 1-2%, something like that, moved off the spectrum, but had some of the residual features. Right, so that's not to say it's hopeless, but it is to say this is a rare phenomenon. We shouldn't count on that. We should just do our best. and we've made progress. But if we're thinking about recovery, if we're thinking about fixing it and get stuck there, that's not a good way to live. It's not a good way to love our child. So now I got a few more minutes to talk about acceptance. And just, you know, what I think it means, how I reflect on it. Helen Keller said the best and most beautiful things in the world cannot be seen or even be touched. They must be felt with the heart. And when my son was little, remember she had a teacher, Emmy Sullivan, who taught her Braille, taught her how to communicate. I thought I was going to be my son's Emmy Sullivan. And I know other parents who thought the same thing. I'm going to be that teacher. But that was not to be. I have videos which show me trying to do this, by the way. I didn't show you those. They're kind of too painful for me to watch. And probably too painful for you to watch. But definitely too painful for me. I'll put that on. There's me and Tariq, like, pretty recently. We go hiking a lot. So this is the way I think of him and experience him all the time. He's autistic all of the time and happy most of the time. Happy most of the time. So when you love someone, you want to be with them, but sometimes the challenges of autism make it difficult to be with somebody with autism. But to find out how we can be together and have fun together and build a relationship together, that's where we have some control. That's where we change Groundhog Day into a good day. Find what we can do together that's mutually enjoyable. And we often have to start with what the child or adult with autism likes. So I have fathers now, this dates me a little, they grew up with video games, and they tell me, and I tell them, well, why don't you play video games with my son? And I tell them, your son. And then they say, oh, that's not the video games I grew up with. And I say, dude, get with it. Yeah, they're not the video games you grew up with. But get where your son is and figure it out. This is your job. This is where you start. So one father, and I just remember him so clearly, because it just hit him after a while. He said, I got to get an Xbox and two controllers. He's fixing it, right? He's fixing it. I said, that's exactly right. And he started building a relationship with his son, who was nine, who played Xbox. And he was playing Xbox with his cousins. His father didn't even know this. You know, he was online with his cousins and kids from his class. He was building a social network through Xbox. And so now his father became a part of it. But, you know, sometimes it's really hard. I had a father and son in my office like last week, and I asked the son, what do you want to do with your father? And he said, I want to have a catch. And his father said, how about a bike ride? I asked his son to leave the room. I said, look, do you want a relationship with your son? The guy goes, yeah. I was like, it's called a catch. And maybe if you do what he wants to do, he will then have fun with you and want to do some other things with you. So this is how we build relationships. This is how we build relationships. And, you know, and likewise for mothers and children, it's not all about therapy. It's not all about being a therapy mom or a therapy dad. It's about building a relationship. It's about having fun. And, of course, yes, you have these therapies in mind, and there are day-to-day things in how you interact that promote development. Yes, all of that's true, but look for fun. That's the missing ingredient. That's the missing vitamin that families need, is enjoying each other. So, I already talked to you about this. So some kids like to play Legos. Like I watched the kid who just banged Legos together, and I sat on the floor with him and his father and his mother, and we stacked the Legos. And, you know, so they started just doing that. And a few years later, I ran into them at an Autism Awareness Day, and they told me their son was building replicas of the mall with Legos. A lot of untapped potential there. And you wouldn't have thought it. This kid that was having tantrums, just banging Legos together, is now building models from his brain, from his imagination. So it's starting where the child is and finding what to do. So a few kind of overarching thoughts, like accepting autism, it doesn't mean wanting it or liking it. Like I've had people tell me, oh, I'll never accept it. Well, I mean, I've certainly been there. And I never wanted to accept it. I still don't want to accept it if I had a choice. But since I don't, I'm okay with it. It doesn't mean you have to like it or change your opinion. It doesn't mean resignation or giving up. It doesn't mean those things. But what does it mean? It's actually about opening up and accepting the full range of emotion. And I think you heard about that yesterday with acceptance commitment therapy. Accepting the full range. To look at possibilities and alternatives, look at the lessons that come with hard experiences and the lessons you're having. Think about what you're learning. And if we have a few minutes, we'll talk about that. So it's a balancing act. So, somehow I zipped out of there. I mean, balancing act. Okay. Balanced rock in Arches National Park. Like, that's amazing, isn't it? Balanced rock. But the balance we need, and I didn't animate this slide, but then it's more like this. It's more like it's always changing. Always different, day by day by day. It's not like you just get to this balance and everything's cool, I'm cool now. It's not like that. But acceptance means doing everything we can and letting go of what we can't. So I think this is the best translation of the Serenity Prayer. This was written in German, and I think the more common translation doesn't capture what this one does. Give us the grace to accept with serenity the things that cannot be changed, courage to change the things that should be changed, and the wisdom to discern the one from the other. So there's an imperative to change the changeable. So we have to look at everything, figure out what's changeable, and gently let go of what's unchangeable. And that's where the wisdom or equanimity comes in. So do you have to be normal to be happy? I don't think so. Jerry Newport, who's an adult with autism, and he's pictured here with his wife, Mary Newport. She was one of the Klingons in Star Trek. She has autism too, by the way. Anyway, he's written a few books. And he put it this way, you don't have to be normal to be happy. And I just extrapolated it a little bit. Nor do you have to make your child or any other autistic person normal to be happy. But it's not an easy journey. But it's rich, and it's full, and it's meaningful. So, these are my books, Autism in the Family, and I'll have some copies of this available later. And Voices from the Spectrum is a collection of essays. People always ask me, what do you recommend lately? All right. Obviously, I like my books, right? It took me years to write them. I was on a mission to write those books. However, If a child is just diagnosed, the first book I would recommend is this one, Uniquely Human, A Different Way of Seeing Autism by Barry Kazan. New book, and it is fabulous. He talks about the concept that there's no such thing as an autistic behavior, they're just human behaviors, and that we're all human. But he talks about his 5 decades as a speech therapist working with children and adults with autism. It's just wonderful. And you can YouTube him and hear him talk about it. I did an interview with him this on YouTube. It's wonderful. And NeuroTribes has the whole history of autism, how it developed, all the controversies. It's about this thick. And you might not want to read the whole thing, but every controversy, and having lived through most of them, he just does a great job of breaking it down. He did research that scientists didn't do into who the characters were. That's really interesting. Like, he did research into who Hans Asperger was and who worked in Asperger's lab and how they turned up in Connor's lab and other people. It's amazing. Amazing book that comes right up to the present and the wave of adults with autism beginning to lead the community and the movement forward. So I'd recommend those two as current books. An Early Start for Your Child with Autism, is the Denver model, and really nuts and bolts about how to work with the symptoms in this blended behavioral and developmental way. It's just like a how-to book. A wonderful book for parents. Life Animated, Ronald Susskind. Another wonderful book about his son, adult son, who learned to communicate through the scripts of Disney movies. And it's a great book. And you can YouTube him and listen to these interviews with him and his son, and like how they did it. And how functional his son became. And how the family like watched these movies for hundreds of times. And his language emerged. Because he had a database of things that fit. Really, you know, these are like the books I read. Okay, so people ask me, like, what do you read? This is what I read. What am I learning about? That's what I learned about. Because really, we can never stop learning this. So this is actually the cover of my first book, and that's that picture you won't remember, with eye contact. And so this is what I learned. And I actually wrote this in a journal, and then it appeared in the book. I tried so hard to change you, and in the end, it was you who changed me. Instead of becoming the son I wanted you to be, you made me become the man I needed to be. So, that's my message. We have like 4 minutes. Questions, reactions, thoughts, feelings. Yes?
I want to say one thing. You're one of the best people I've ever heard talk about this subject. You hit so many of the things that it, you know, a person who's lived with autism for 57 years, I mean, I almost want to cry. You've actually made it so fantastic, and you're saying so much of the things that need to be said. I just want to say thank you.
There's a spiritual part of this journey. This will take you deep into the depths of who you are. And you can come through that dark night of the soul and have a full life. And be happy, be proud, and live with joy, and live with meaning. So that's what I wish for all of you. To be well, be happy, and live with autism, and enjoy the process of living and learning and being all we can be. So I thank you for listening. It means the world to me.